it's hard in real life, but I would like to be involved again with running. It's like, it's this year takes, and here takes up a large amount of time, and I'm doing it for my master's at the moment too, like, so. So we kind of, as much as you like to, you kind of don't mind as well, like, so whatever happens, happens. Cathal, welcome to the podcast. Good to be on.
It's good to be here.
It's good to see a bit of a baller getting down the road there.
How great it is in the sort of middle of nowhere.
It's not the epic center, is it, of the north?
Got here, and that's almost
that's good. That's good. You were telling me there before we started, is there still playing football at the moment then?
I'm still playing for the club. Still two more games left. Training away. See how the rest of the fixtures. Our club at the minute is running for playoffs, so that's the aim. We're going to go through the playoffs and try and do as best as we can. And Division 1 is still possible for the team.
Yeah. It's a long year for you. It's like, is it usually, do you usually be finished at this time, or is it kind of always around this time?
I think last year actually was a bit, we finished a little bit sooner, but I think last year we missed out in the playoffs, so I'd say our season we didn't carry on the giveaway. I know maybe the year before, I think no, it's not really just kind of stuff around this time. I don't think it's been gone as long. But I do know that if obviously the next two games go well, then we could be looking at the last 2 weeks somewhere.
One year, that's essentially a league, like, isn't it? 2 weeks ago.
That's it. The league championship run, we got the semi final, my biggest bit point. And then yourself, it's hard to sort of
motivate yourself,
get back at it. But to be fair, our lads stuck at it, and the numbers in June, I think that's key. Our aim is to get to Division 1, so just give the playoffs another battle, and hopefully.
You guys were a junior though, were you? A couple of years ago?
We were only there for three years ago.
Right.
And when I was growing up, I was always watching on those in junior, and it wasn't nice. It wasn't pretty. You always seen the lads, some of the older fellas that's not playing now. They're always good, hard players, and you looked up to them, but you just didn't have that run the green, or that better luck to make an intermediate. So then basically, I know from since I've come on board, I think we're in Division 3 for 2 years, and then after that we got promoted. Things started to look up, and I think that's where you want to be. You want to be in Division 3 playing your football. But the one thing I would say is, when it's in Division 3, when you get in, when you're in Division 3, it is hard to get out, because it is a very competitive league.
Yeah.
And we're in Division 2 now, the last 2 years, and we've cemented our spot.
We've
managed to stay safe.
And now you're pushing for promotion, are they?
That's basically it, that's the plan.
It's a big turnaround, like, because for most teams, like, the jump from junior to intermediate, because I know we done it a couple of years ago, and it is a big jump, like. I think the difference being, like, in junior, you have a couple of the good teams, and you have a couple of teams that just aren't at the level, and intermediate. Especially in Derry, any team on the day could probably be the other team, like, there's no clear favourites, it is a big jump, like.
I think even if you look at the league now, there's a few teams sitting at about 11 or 12 points who could possibly still make playoffs.
Right.
But, if you're chatting then, I think they're actually worrying about getting maybe caught up in their relegation battle as well.
Yeah.
So it shows you how competitive it is. Even there, I would say Division 3, you're 100% correct. There's two or three teams at the top, normally always go ahead and stay ahead.
Yeah.
But the thing in Division 3 is, it's easy to be brought down to, a bad level, but it's easy
you
to
play at the standards you're playing at.
Yeah, it's probably harder to motivate yourself to be, playing regularly at a high level each week. Whereas in Division 3, you're knowing that you're going to go up against tough opposition.
Do you find that, like, would there be many players in your own panel that we're playing in the junior league, or is it fairly even, or is it usually in the top leagues that the players are coming from?
I think from my end, whenever I was playing the Oisin ball, throwing when I was playing the UFC football. I think maybe that time there's only a few players, Ben Yar and Newton Stewart. I'd say he always had a lot of training about me, always looking forward to who you might be marking in a club game, but I've actually never had that. I know I've had it recently, and we were part two Papi Yeri from Roy, and before that I haven't had that at all. So probably when I was in Division 3, I was the only player on the county team, and then now this last couple of years, Patsy, so that was a funny enough battle.
How did, what way did that go then?
I'd say I did better.
You're gonna say that maybe too. Yeah, I think that, you know, it's funny, even in intermediate and Derry and junior and stuff, there probably isn't that many players in there that are playing county, and you wonder, is it, and it's probably seems wrong, like, is the standard of players better in Division 1, or is it just that, like, players just get seen more in Division 1, do you think?
I think maybe that is correct. If you see, I don't know what you're going to have to the 10s and games, Division 1 games, and the championship, Division 1 games attract a big crowd. You look at Division 3, you know, I could maybe 4 or 5 men looking in there, but are good quality players as well. But again, I think it helps if you're up playing against the better teams, you're gonna be training harder, you're gonna be, you know, added more.
Standards
are higher. I think when I was in Division 3, I'd be getting the bad habits. Mm-hmm. And I know it's easy to say that and all the rest, but I do believe whenever you're up playing against the better players and better teams, you're making sure that your performances are better.
Yeah, you raise it, like, don't you? You've had a bit of a crazy year. You kind of, you were a top scorer this year in championship.
That's correct.
349.
It's around that, aren't
you? Around that. That's, like, describe the past year. Like, has it been mad, or has it just been a normal year? Have you expected that of yourself? Or?
I would say it has been a bit of a rollercoaster year, to be honest. You know, coming in the start, you obviously want to get off the season, you want to get off a good start, you want to sort of cement your spot for the year. I know obviously we were coming in from the previous year, getting the Oscar final, and when I reviewed the year and seeing how we had done and the team had done, I was happy with how you had played. Obviously, you're always looking to improve and seeking to improve, but that year then, this year, we were playing, tried out a few different things, and you know, in the County Cup, I was actually playing half forward, out the field a bit more. I think a few other games, I was in the 15th year, I was given the license to sort of come out the field and you know, roam the way I wanted. But as the season progressed, I think maybe in training, we tried a few times I was in the full forward, and you know, that it went well. It's weird because it comes down to maybe one or two plays that might just go well, and then you're thinking, you know, can you try that, or can we go with that? And fair, I've loved it in there. It's did a lot of work with Stevie and Neil and working on movement and different things, so that definitely helped me. And as I say, I did enjoy it in this year.
Yeah, like that transition to full forward just seemed to be a game changer. It even just seemed to change the complete style you just played with last year as well. Was it tough changing? Because, like, would you play full forward before? You'd always been around.
From club, I've always played full forward, I've always had a 19 jersey on. And it's coming next back in the Division 2. I've noticed that seasons we've run to Division 2, maybe sometimes it's an option to come out the field more because just to help the team more. But whenever I was coming up to control, I was always 14 playing full forward. So I didn't know the role, I didn't know what was used there, if you get me. But my early career in Tyrone, I was always seeing myself as fit, and you know, I liked covering good distance in games, so that's what helped me play out the field.
Yeah.
But no, it's used to the position, and I felt that, you know, do well in this year.
I think 348 serious scoring.
I know when you think about it, obviously you're going to have games to do the best you can. Yeah. And, you know, I wasn't even really, to be honest, wasn't really worrying about that. Didn't enter my mind because I was just eager to perform and to do as best I could and score as much as I could. But obviously, you're doing that when you have the team in mind and you're setting up as well. Guys getting huge assists, 4 or 5 assists a game, and you know, that's something that I was looking at. I was looking at, if I set up a score, you know, I was going to say, like, that's good work.
Yeah. Why do you think it's kind of been, I know that, you know, it's 1 year, but why do you think it's been as effective as it has been, you know, this year especially?
There's a lot of things that, it's, I think too, with experience, you just learn to, learn from so many, maybe a few years ago, not having that experience, make silly mistakes that you know you shouldn't be making, but at the end of the day, you know that you can't be making them at that level, you know you're not going to be playing. I know I did a lot of work in self-review, I did a lot of work in the gym as well. I felt that obviously I looked at, you know, other players who performed at the top of level, and it seemed that they were maybe a bit heavier, or you know, things like that. So I was in the gym, I wanted to get heavier and I wanted to make sure that I was stronger and more powerful for the year. Definitely did that. I made myself a lot more powerful, a lot stronger this year, which I think helped me in there as well.
I think too, like, you don't even, obviously you have to have speed and acceleration, but because of your size, if you get out in front of a man, they're not going to get out in front of you on the ball. Like, you know, you'll always have to run to you nearly, whereas if you're that wee bit smaller, that bigger fullback can kind of maybe get around it. Like,
push you on the road, or maybe it's something that's saying maybe bully, but it's something that I definitely worked on, and it definitely helped me. But again, with the work of maybe making my runs better and trying to lose a defender, the work I did in training, that also gave me an advantage as well, along with the strength and power that I brought. So I definitely enjoyed it in there, and it was definitely worth it. So,
yeah, definitely seemed to pay off. Do you think the rule changes that kick into 45 and get a little help you or hinder you next year?
It was handy enough. It's not a league last year, I'm not gonna lie. We went in there and almost like you just playing the game, but it's normal.
Yeah.
You do know what's there, and if you can, you take the most out of it. And I do believe sometimes when you take the mark, maybe you could have went on and got a goal.
Yeah.
You know, I caught one against Dublin, Paddy Hampsey, and I remember it very well. Paddy Hampsey, I was sitting about on the right side, the whole stand of poker. Pings it in against Dublin in the league, and I caught it, and it took me a mark. It was probably the stage the game was good, because I think there's only 5 or 6 minutes left, and I took the point, but maybe in a champion game, or you know, you'd be catching that and thinking, it's good to go.
Yeah. What do you think of all the rule changes, like in the 2 this year? What do you think of the rule changes for the past couple of years in New Zealand?
To be honest, the only one that I actually was totally against was the special.
It seems like a disaster. Both of them played well.
That was crazy. Even the referees were crazy, you know what I mean? Sometimes trying them out, and they just were getting them wrong, and they were admitting that they got them wrong as well on the pitch. I remember it was just maybe Derry or Armada that we played up in the weekend cup last year.
There was a couple of bad ones.
It just didn't work well, and you were sort of, it was actually laughable the way it was going, but as a player, you just obviously have to get on with it, and you know, you don't control when it does come in.
Yeah.
But
I think sometimes, like, it just seems like any wee negative in the game they're trying to fix or sort, and it maybe leads to more problems and issues, and sometimes you need to just let it run its course.
Just slow it, let it be, and then as it goes, right?
I had Cam Brown in the podcast yesterday, and sort of saying that it nearly seems like they're trying to turn the game into the AFL with all the marks and the style of it now.
I see a lot of people writing on Twitter about that now, saying about how the mark is more or less relating to the Oslo game, but don't get me wrong, if you can make use of it and it's happy, then you know, why not? But here's the saying, we as footballers, we just like just worry about it and get on with it.
Yeah. What do you think of Toronto last year then? Were you obviously disappointed, but did you know what your kind of thoughts at the end of it like?
Sitting back and looking and reviewing, we were very disappointed, you know, with the semi-final defeat, because we knew that we could have won that game, we should have won the game. We were 4 points up at half time. It was probably the best first half we played all year. But obviously getting into half time, you know that the game's not over, so it's only halfway. You're planning to come out the second half and do what you did much better, even. But overall, we were happy in terms of a feeling that we improved a lot from the previous year. And you know, you look at the previous year and we got to the final. People say, "You're mad. How did you improve?" If you didn't get to the final, but we actually improved in loads of areas of the game, which maybe we didn't have the year before.
Yeah.
But again, it's all down to the one silverware, and we didn't do that this year, which was disappointing, but again, it just makes you hungry going forward.
Yeah, it doesn't demotivate you whenever you kind of get them losses. It's a motivating factor then, like.
Don't get me wrong, it was tough to take the care game whenever you're at home and you know, you're sort of thinking about it and viewing it, but the more you look at it, the more you watch it, then there is positives to take out of it as well.
Yeah.
And I think how the whole year progressed, there was lots of positives to take out of the year and going into the next season.
I think even if you look at the state of play, you know, your state of play seemed to change last year in a positive way, simply because you're getting more scores. Although probably the placings maybe didn't suggest that, it would probably, from the outside looking, it probably looked like the overall game improved. maybe just didn't reflect on the pitch, obviously. Like, but
well, I think obviously it's important to keep your your options open in terms of you know, there's times where you can go and play that, you know, forward playing,
yeah.
You know, that attack of football. Obviously there's times too, you know, you can have to invert and where you're playing and depends on who you come up against, and you know, it depends what the situation of the game. You might have to go into being the defensive part of the game and then moving forward into attacking the game. But I do know that we certainly feel that we were more attacking last year, and we worked on that a lot of training. People outside have their opinions no matter what. I think it's growing, people have their opinions on that.
Yeah.
I know, I think maybe Cornel spoke on this,
yeah.
Spoke on as well, but it's
what
we know we're going the right way.
What do you think people's perception is of Tyrone?
It seems to be just be different. You know, I've watched those again this year and even last year where, you know, the top teams are putting them behind the ball and they're working hard. They're working hard for the jersey, working hard for the fans, working hard for the cause. But they're putting them behind the ball and you wouldn't hear much about it after the game.
Yeah.
But then if Tyrone seemed to do it, it seemed to be the talking point of maybe 5 or 6 minutes after the game, and you're just thinking, why is that? But, shooting away, but again, we don't worry about the game, it just drives us on the
time. It just seems to be one of the things that's present every year, like, but it's strange that why do you think that is the case every year?
I honestly don't know. I think it's just Tyrone. I actually have no clue. Again, I don't get too much involved in it or don't worry too much about it, because obviously you hear it or you see it. You know, you're going to have your thought on it in that moment in time, but again, as the season goes on and you know, you're training 3, 4, 5 nights a week, that's not anything that we worry about, if you mean.
I forget about it, like,
yeah.
I think the thing is too, and you'll have better ideas than probably anyone else's unless you're on the panel, there's so much noise that the fact there's so much probably drowns it all out. You know, there's that much stuff coming in probably Twitter, and then there's stuff out on YouTube, there's stuff on TV that nearly probably all drowns out because there's so much shit being said.
That's it. But again, I think it's just important as players, you just get on with it and you train hard and
yeah.
Work away, because if you worry about that, then you know it starts to affect your game or whatever. We know when we play, we have a plan and what we have to do, and we believe in that, if you get me. So, you know, people do speak and people are entitled to their opinion, but you know, I just think that sometimes it's not really necessary, and you know, if they were to sort of think about what they're saying more or less, hopefully in the future.
Yeah, well, that's like the unfortunate thing is you kind of don't really have any control over it. Like, you have to get on. What way do you think you've maybe perceived over the past couple of years, like,
in terms of
as a player, in terms of off the pitch, on the pitch? You know, do you think your view seem like as a kind of Tyrone way, or people maybe negative, or do you think it's positive, or have you ever thought about it?
It's something that you look at. I'm in social media, all aspects of it. I do know that sometimes you get tagged in things and stuff that,
mm-hmm.
You know, it's not really positive in a way, but
yeah.
Again, I actually use that to drive me on, and you know, I don't let it affect me too much, because if you did, then you're just it's really sad if you did it.
Yeah.
That's what I believe. I know coming through Tyrone, I sort of been in and out of the squad as well at times, you know, been playing, and then years of wouldn't be playing, and
yeah.
You know, people will probably have their opinion saying whether it's the standard or not, just like every player, you know, people will talk and you know, have their opinion on them, but I would say maybe just getting that experience has helped me now really settle as a player and, you know, wanting to improve going forward, and I think people watching will have seen that, and maybe in the years past I've made silly mistakes when, you know, it wasn't necessary. I know obviously I've done a goal game, a championship, you know, my debut, I made a few mistakes that day that wasn't down to the ball defence or anything like that, it was just down to individual errors. So it's just a matter of working on that and putting it aside and getting that experience. And
yeah.
I think people now see that, you know, I've sort of worked on that and it happened pretty soon.
Yeah, it is. Like, I'm guessing it's experience too, like, and just it takes time, but you probably learn more from that than if you went and had a perfect game that day. Like,
that's it, because like this year is an example of the Cathal game where I was taken off in the second half.
Yeah.
It wasn't my best game, and you know, I tried a few things that day that just didn't come off, and you know, I could have sulked with that, but instead I decided, you know, get back at it and work hard here, because we're at Dublin next week. It's probably the best thing that I had happened me, because I went back to training Tuesday and was flying and I got a few good scores, I just felt so good.
Yeah.
And then that led them to the Dublin game the weekend where I got the 1-4, I think, and
I had been fired in
this, so it does you no harm. Sometimes, you know, having a performance gap is obviously at the time, it's really, really tough to deal with when you're really dead down about it, but if you really use it the right way, then you can react well and use it as a positive going forward.
Yeah, I think that's an important thing, it's happened maybe before, you know, if you do have a bad game, or maybe if you get, you know, taken off, that you only maybe focus on the negative of it, but
yeah.
As you say, if you can, I think it's important people are listening to, like, because you will get dropped or you will have a shit game at some point, trying to find somewhere to use that as a positive or a motivating factor should be the way that you view it, like, shouldn't it?
Yeah, no, 100%, I agree with that. You know, I can think of loads of times whenever it hasn't worked well for me, and I can even go back to the full minors.
Mm-hmm.
I was in the team, and you know, we went to the All Ireland final that year and beat the Mayo, but I thought that the team was in a really good place and training well and stuff, but I just wasn't getting that, you know, selected for the starting
mm-hmm.
team. And you know, that year obviously finishes, and then you maybe have a bit of a gap before the under 21. And that year finished, and I probably had a choice, again, to talk about moving that time as much as I wanted to, or could have worked hard. And you know, I mean, that the week after that, I was back in the gym working hard and training to make sure that, you know, I was going to give myself the best chance to progress through. And you know, the year after I was in the under 21 team, and then I went from there and got on the senior team. And
you
know, I've been lucky that that's the way it's went. But you know, I always say that I work hard and believe that you know, good things will happen if you really do train hard and you know, have your game, and that's what I tend to do then.
Yeah. And I think what you said there is, even at minor level, whenever that happens, you know, in the 21s, it kind of spurs you on, and it kind of, you know, maybe it takes a couple of years, and then it kind of all seems to click, like last year, you know, everything probably just seemed to fall into place, all those years of doing that work and everything, and you're kind of sitting back thinking, fuck, that's what I done, like, it kind of all makes sense now, whereas maybe there's a lot of times, and maybe for people that are listening, you're wondering why you're doing this here, but sometimes it just clicks, like.
I think there's obviously a lot of things that happen. You know, you get to the stage too, where maybe you're again, like this year, I've been full forward. If I went out the pitch, you know, the season can went a completely different way. You know what I mean? I get in there nice and early, and I said that, you know, knew what I was about, and knew what I had to do in there, and I was told what I had to do. And you know, knew working with Stevie, that I could work on certain aspects of the game and improve your runs, and that definitely helped me prepare for this year. But there's so many different things you can see yourself. You know, just getting the rub of the green, or maybe if you know, getting that chance that if maybe you do make a mistake here, put it in the back of your mind and go again.
Yeah.
Whereas when you're young and don't have that experience, you're probably maybe thinking, you know, should I have him on the pitch, or you know, should he be playing my team, or you know what I mean? So once you get that experience is key, and you have to just make sure you put it to use.
Yeah, that's an important thing. Like, I think the same as anything, whether it be the training doing the pitch, the training doing the gym. You just have to put it to use, and it takes that experience of knowing that it's not going to click maybe straight away. It takes a wee bit of time, a wee bit of patience, like, which is probably a hard thing for people to do.
It's hard because obviously I'm in this my 5th or 6th season now in the team. And if you were to look back at that, I've come in, and to be fair, I've been loads of chances, and I've been been very, very appreciative of that, because obviously growing up, that's what I want to do. When you're watching a man get out of the club park for the first time, just like as a spectator, you know, you always dream of pulling on the Trojan jersey, and it's crazy to believe, you know, if I even seeing some of the guys at Brian Gifford was always my school, Steve Mayno was my school, I was in awe of them, if you get me. You know, you're always thinking, that's where I want to be, that's who I want to be, or whatever. But now when you're there, you're obviously training so hard, and you put so much into it, but maybe you don't feel that, if you get me, you don't feel that sort of importance, because you still know kids look up to you, but as in, you put yourself back in your shoes and you think what you were like when you were young, you get this special feeling, and you know, kids do that now looking at us, so that's where we're.
That's crazy, like, you know, you are, like, there's kids that saying the exact same thing, like, you know, that they want to play the way you're playing, they want to be like you. That must be a mad feeling, like.
It is, it's crazy, because obviously, you know, you're in their shoes one day, and you know, I go to schools and talk to kids and stuff, and I always say, but it does go really, really fast. You know, it seems no time since you were sitting watching Toronto. So now, you know, I don't take it for granted, because whatever you call that Toronto jersey, you have to be so appreciative of it, and you have to wear it with pride. And you know, I'm lucky to do that, to be able to represent my country and represent the people of Toronto. And it's something that you just love. You get me, you have a passion for it, you just love doing it.
Yeah, and I'm guessing. Like, I know Conor's been on the podcast for us, you know, because he went over all the training plan and stuff, but just train a lot. Like, that obviously makes it all worth it, I'm guessing.
It's there's a lot of errors going there. Again, the reason we do it is because we love it. I know Colin might have mentioned a typical week to you,
yeah.
I think, and you know, it is, there's a lot of errors on it.
Well, just go through it, Trinidad hasn't listened to that, just briefly go through yours, and then you're a wee bit further away too than from the training pit.
Right, maybe an hour, 5 minutes.
Just a wee bit.
If we had a typical week, I know it changes in terms of when you're, depending on what stage of the season you're at, or what route you've went, or
yeah.
things like that, but a typical week, you're in a good gym session on Monday,
yeah.
Get the collective, so you're doing it 3 hours a team. On Tuesday night, during the pitch, and then on Wednesday night, you sort of might have an option to do your own gym session or do your own recovery session.
Yeah.
So again, you're out of the house and you're away doing that. And Thursday night, you're back in the field.
Yeah.
It all depends on if you have a game. Say, if you had a game on Saturday and it's away in Dublin, then you could even on Friday get prepared for that. But again, Friday night, if you didn't have a game that weekend, it'd be seen as a bit of a recovery session because you know on Sunday you're going to be, or Saturday or Sunday you're going to be training. So I do know it's 4 or 5 nights a week, but again, it's good with you yourself here and the strength and conditioning stuff. It's, when you're doing your sessions and all, it is good. You have that banter with the lads and
yeah.
you know, you enjoy it big time.
I think that's it, and you know, maybe it's some kind of a reason. Only realizing maybe I chat about you, sometimes chat about the negatives of having to train so much and put so much time in, but like as you said, you wouldn't do it unless you wanted to.
That's it. As I say, maybe people obviously have different aims in life, and you know, maybe if you're looking at a club's perspective, or whatever, maybe they have more important things, but if you're in the Cardino, that's obviously really important to me, you know, and I know it's for the other kind of player, you're in there, and there's a lot of hours, but again, it's why for those hours you put in, you then see once then you go run around the Croke Park, or you want a championship, or you want the Ireland, that's when it all then is all the work that you get.
I think it's, you know, even not everybody has that opportunity, but the fact of still training that amount and being around your team, whether it be club level, whether it be in the gym, you know, in groups and stuff, there's something really, you know, important about that there, being part of a group and training. Like, I think if you're viewing it as a negative that you have to go out 4 or 5 nights a week, you know, there's something wrong there. Like, you should be looking to do that because of social and physical things.
I wouldn't say that would be the way you should look at it, because as you say, socializing, talking to your teammates, making friends, you know, if you look at the community, fact that even you look at my felt last day, you know, the interview given after that, I mean, the other day, and to be honest and stuff, and you know, that is 100% true, and that was a great interview. I know my team, probably again going forward, you know, we are a small community, and them one in millions, and you know, as we say, our journey hasn't been maybe as big as maybe some other journeys, because obviously we're coming from division 3 and 2, but we obviously are planning to move forward and grow and get bigger and bigger. But you're 100% right, for just the whole social side of things and getting out, just enjoying, that's really the most important thing, you have to be enjoying it.
I think so, and you know, for a lot of people, you're all there, then could be fucking winning the playoffs, it could be winning the intermediate or championship, whatever it is. Like, I know the team that beat us this year in the championship for Glen, they fairly played really well and they won the championship. They've been on the rink, I think, for the entire week.
Like, it's actually,
but that's class, like,
it's class.
That's what it's all about, to be honest. And
that's why I love, don't get me wrong, whenever Toronto finishes, because you're there so long, you do miss it in a way, because it just changes. You're going back to the same level, and
yeah.
you know, at the end of the day, it is going to be a different level. But you know, see, whenever you go back to your clubmates who you've trained with all your life, there's something special with that, and you know, it's class. Whenever I know we only won the Division 3 title 3 years ago, or whatever it was, but again, those were special moments. You could see people in our club, you know, it's really not had that feeling in a while. Even if your mom, your modern father, your family members, the whole lot, brings the whole community together, and you know, that is important.
I definitely like, and I know for us, like, we're kind of probably similar voltages, like we're Division 3, and like, I would say the same way, but like, I feel that we should be probably winning the championship, and hopefully in the next couple of years we will, and I know that whenever we do, because we haven't won a championship since the 90s, it'll be a really special thing. Like, that'll be the majority of our boys all Ireland, you know, that's that's the big day, like.
Do you think, too, even yourself, like, that's what you dream of, is obviously one in your club, that's where you start out, you know what I mean? Obviously, yeah. Then you go into your own massive as well, and you know, you get the chance to play pro part in Ireland and all the rest of the top players and county and stuff. But the club mates and guys, you start out in under 8s and under 10s and stuff, and that's, there's something unique about that.
Yes.
And, you know, it's the same, sometimes whenever we won the four rows, I meet with the lads and just again, they deserve that, like, because they've worked so hard for it. And I know whenever I'm playing a show and every one of the lads is behind me, giving them the most support they can and hoping that I do well. So you know, that's something about the future too, for the club will be great.
Yeah, hope so. You've been nominated for an All-Star?
Yeah.
So, coming up Cathal, how is it?
The first one.
How does that work? Do you just see it online? Do they message you? How does one get an All-Star nomination?
I can't. You just get the notification on the phone.
Just get an Instagram tag on.
Comes up, you can tag in a photo. No, it's just off the game, which is.
Yeah.
It's something that, to be honest, when you're growing up, you obviously gain. I'd say it's 30 years, I'm just never that out of my mind.
Yeah.
You nominated it, I know people were saying last year about. I just went on the street, oh, you're unlucky not to be nominated and all this. But I didn't know too much about it. Obviously, get the message to say I've been nominated, and you know, that's brilliant for me. I think we run in with Mali, and you know, we got to our semi final. You could say that there should be more down there as well, but it's definitely a night to enjoy, just go down and have a bit of crack with the lads. And
is that next week, is it?
The first, Friday the first, so it's not this Friday after.
I'm not going to play the session more.
Possibly could be.
Yes.
I mean, I think McNeil there, Robin, he's with the effort to Saturday, is that?
Dublin, is it?
Yeah, Dublin, playing in the PWC arena, I think it is. So.
Do you know more in New York?
Yeah,
I remember.
I was just quiet a few days.
Yeah, just over there. That's fucking shit.
No, I was actually in somebody good experience. I'm right there with the puncture room, looking after the children and pick the boy. But I met some great people, and it's actually. I get my eyes open, the action done, whatever comes out there for, you know, in terms of Toronto and whatnot, but meet some great people, some mad Toronto men that live out there and are so eager and so, you know, dying for us to do so well and have so much success.
Probably forget that that's even there, could they completely see that?
That's crazy. As I was saying, you're running my home, that trip I had was just immense. I was like, speaking to people that I never thought I'd ever meet. And, you know, whenever you actually get speaking to them, you realise maybe that they're good to you and what you might never have known of yet. But I've met some great people, and you know, it's just crazy to see what they're at over there and how much they still are so interested in Tyrone and watching the games and tuning in and everything.
Yeah, you forget that, like, but I think that until you chat the boys that are maybe out there and playing and stuff, like, it's really. So there's like in Ireland out there and some of the new clubs and stuff like
that. Mm-hmm. Pride in them. We ride in Rockland GAA. Do you want to see the numbers? The numbers are crazy. The facility was crazy. The setup they had was unbelievable. And you know, we had a bit of a chat night out there. And it was a great trip, a great experience. And
yeah,
you know, it was good to sort of have your eyes open and see the work that goes on out there in terms of the GAA and stuff. And some great people out there.
Did you make it to the main fiddler?
Mean fiddler, yeah, I think so.
No, we did. I did.
We did. We can't write too much about it. But
it's it's like a famous Irish bar in Times Square, but it's like the one you go to. I've been a couple of times. I'm talking about fucking living in New York. I've been a couple of times. And you always end up in the Times Square and you look about for a bar, and it's the first one you find. It's got like pictures of some of the Dublin players on the wall and stuff, and it's you have some amazing memories from them, right?
No, it's definitely. It's a few guys, I think just a quick day, the boxer, Billy Goddard, who's messaged me about it. I think they do a bit of sponsorship with him.
Right.
I think he was saying they need to go there. Now, I have been in New York before, so I was in it before, but again, I didn't know much about it. But again, people were saying, oh, it's definitely one of the best spots to go to now.
New York's been in the city, isn't it?
It's class. Again, we were down in the city for 2 or 3 days, so it was actually a bit. The trip was quite busy. We were down there for 2 or 3 days, and things to do, and then we obviously moved up then a bit, and about 40 minutes outside the city, up towards the Rockland, for the talk. But no, it's amazing city. It's classy out there, and it is one of my favourite holiday destinations.
Did you ever see yourself going out to Finland before, America?
Not anytime soon, to be honest, because I'm looking a couple of years too much. Maybe when I'm hitting 30s. For some of them, I'm taking it anyway, but
I'm sure you've been offered a few nice summers, have you?
I think, being honest, I think people probably know. Sort of, you know, it depends on your situation in terms of playing.
I definitely don't know my opinion on the duty.
Because I go down to 21s. Whenever I finished them, I had the opportunity to go out and had a few offers, and you know, that was the year I took my championship debut and yeah. It all, but actually it was never going to enter my mind. I just wanted to play with my own.
Yeah.
You know, that was a easy decision for me. That was the first big option I've had. Now I have, people are always, you always get that message from someone, but
yeah.
Half the time I don't even open it. Just keep it on my head. No, it is something maybe in the future, I want to know it out, but it's not anytime soon.
Yeah, I'll say, I suppose if you're enjoying football through on, you're going well, like it's probably
that's it,
like how silly they let do that, you know, like
100%. That's 100%. As you say, you can not sure to open the best goals for you, so
yeah,
that's it.
You were chatting about the gym work you were doing there. How much gym work? Like, would you do a lot of gym work? Do you like the gym? Or is it just one of the things you kind of do because you have to do it?
No, I personally love the gym. Again, it's that whole environment, you're in with your teammates and you're enjoying it, and there's a real sense of pride when you know whenever the gym's buzzing and the tunes are pumping, all the lads are feeling good and stuff, and you know, it's, you're really cheering each other on and stuff, and you know, it sort of leads to a good pit session the night after as well, especially whenever you're in your practice session. I know personally, whenever our season finished last year, I wanted to do a lot of work in terms of to grow my physique. Because I knew that I was in around 13 stone, and I was looking at the top players, they were on around 14, so I was thinking there's no reason why I can't get to that level as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I know that in the pre-season last year I was slightly over 14, once I completed my sort of, what would you say, a bulk session,
yeah.
You know, just working hard at the gym, did a private sessions in Derry and stuff, and you know, it worked well, because I knew myself, well, if I was to get bigger and stuff, away from throne, once I go back to the gym and do all the training and do the athletic stuff, I was starting to come into shape, and you know, fitness wouldn't be a problem.
So I think you didn't feel that putting on that wee bit of size in the off season negatively affected you?
No, definitely not. There was a lot of calories that I consumed. I was up around 3.5, 3.6, maybe some days 3.8 a day.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was crazy eating and all the interim sessions, but I have no regrets about it whatsoever, because again, once you're back in, you're training hard, you always sign yourself, you know, starting to lose that bit of weight throughout the season because your training's
really off.
So
just
so.
And I think that's important because people are always, I think, maybe a wee bit skeptical about doing too much gym work, putting on too much size, especially in the off season, because they'll maybe negatively affect your performance. But I think you probably have a good idea yourself if it will or if it won't.
I think there is a line. You know,
yeah.
You sort of know whenever I'm getting too big, or you know, I'm not fit enough to carry that, or I'm not fit enough to do this. There's a line, but I knew right there, because I was looking at guys in around 14 and they were up and down the pitch and all the rest. So I knew that, you know, fitness was one of my strengths. So I was thinking that, you know, I there's no reason why I shouldn't ever do that. And as I say, then obviously my game was inside, so I definitely felt that I was a lot more powerful and a lot stronger throughout the season.
I think as time goes on too, you get a better sort of handle on your body and you know what you should do and what you shouldn't do. Like, I know for me, if I get too big, it'll negatively affect me in terms of speed and moving.
You know your own body.
You know your body, and there's other bodies that if you're naturally quick and you naturally have an acceleration, you can probably put on that bit of size. It's not going to affect you too much. You know, it's probably a bit of experience getting that, but I think most people probably have an idea of what they need to do. Like,
it's probably important to you know, your mobility work.
Yeah.
You know, you can't neglect that, because obviously if you're getting big and trying to get yourself stronger and more powerful, then if you neglect your mobile body work, then you probably could maybe you'd notice yourself maybe picking up injuries or something like that. But I think it's just a matter of like, watching it and saying, you know, the line, and you know, when they
that's
it, like, taper it.
I think you know, you say with experience, you get that, but that thing is like a mobility too. It's, we've said on a couple of podcasts, it's like the wee 1% thing. It's like nobody really likes doing mobility, and you're sitting thinking when you're doing one stretch, you're like, is this actually going to do anything? But it's the cumulative effect of doing that, that's the same as like, you know, making sure you sleep 7-8 hours, making sure you're doing, you know, maybe a run every week. Like, it's those wee things, the 1% to add up massively,
and then it can make a big difference.
And that's it, like, who is the biggest lifters in the Toronto team? Who's got the biggest bench?
So we're all
here to find out.
Biggest bench. Again, it's maybe. I think you have a guess.
I'd say you're probably going to be up around there.
No, I find it weird because I think benching is, you know, once you get into good technique, uh-huh. You see guys that maybe isn't that. Don't look that big, but they can bench. Not a technique. But no, don't get me wrong, it would be up around there. You're pretty hard as well. He's very, very strong and good at it. Richie, Ronan McNamee. Strong and Maddie, yeah. I know, but again, it's very, you'd be surprised to see someone yeah. Like he can bench the whole time and then say he doesn't because it's all a technique and know how to do it correctly.
That's it. Like I've found that in training people in here for the past kind of year and a half, like you can build your bench press up massively, even just as you say, if your technique is good. I would say about 90% of people sit down to bench, your technique is terrible.
No, you see that? I'm trying to think of an example. It's not coming to me, but again, just knowing some people are doing like the bench a lot because of their size and they're bold. But again, when it comes to it, they're probably going to be nothing more than yourself.
What's going on here?
This isn't right,
yeah.
Or whatever. But those guys in the other mix, they're really good. You know, Frank Burns, he needs better work.
Does it?
Through his eyes.
That's a problem, right there.
Sorry, I forgot about Polly Hampson.
Aye.
Yeah, I've been there.
A couple of big benches, and that's what we're getting at.
That's it.
What's the goals now then going forward? Like looking pre-season, looking next year? Have you got the goals or are you kind of looking up further?
The moment, obviously, just concentrate really on the club and trying to see the season for them and trying to see where that takes us. As I said at the start, we're in the straight of playoffs now. So, one or next 2 games, we're going to have a few more games after that then. So, the goal then is obviously. Get a bit of rest, get the body right, and then you'll be back at it. So we're starting up very soon again. You know, it's starting an hour long year, you know what I mean? So you just sort of have to make sure you get your body right, make sure you're at the right level, make sure you can perform the best you can. Again, obviously, for myself, maybe coming off one of my best years, I'll be looking to maintain that and go better because at the end of the day, no matter how good you have been throughout the year, there's always areas and aspects of your game that you can improve on. And you know, I watch a lot of videos and whatnot and stuff, so I have so many areas in my game that I can improve on.
Yeah.
And I know, and with the help of others as well, and I'm working on to make sure that I can.
And would you watch a lot of your own game, like, you know, or watching other players play to learn stuff? Or?
I probably a bit of both. Yeah. Obviously, it's all about yourself. You watch a game, and it's actually quite weird sometimes to watch yourself because you're thinking, you know, if you make a mistake, why you did I do that or something, you know what I mean? But you get used to it, because obviously the video works, it's key.
You used to so much of it now, like,
not much of it, and it's a big part of it, so you get well used to it, and you just watch, you know, always trying to see what you can do better. Again, you're looking at things maybe when you missed, and you know, what could you do better next time, basically.
Yeah, so that's obviously a big thing for you, and then that's kind of how you're going to maybe decide in the wee areas that you can improve on next year, then. So, with coming up to games, have you any kind of, people always love asking the same time, do you have a pre-match meal, pre-match rituals, anything like that?
Again, with Tyrone, we eat 3 hours before the game, mm-hmm. So you're always eating, depends on the game, what time the game's at. Like, if I get up, leave the game at 2 or 3 o'clock, you're probably going to have your breakfast around 9, you know, early enough, and then you're probably taking a bit of a snack. And then obviously three hours before the game, so the game's at 3, then you know 12, you'll be getting your pre-match lead, so you don't want to be too much. Well, I know myself, I don't want to be able to eat your guys. I love eating loads before the game, maybe love eating loads maybe closer to the game as well. It's just different people, but again, you know, I just go with the flow, to be honest.
I don't think about it too much.
I don't think too much about it, because I think if you do that, then it's sort of affecting you in a bad way, maybe.
It's on your mind too much, you know. If you mess up maybe one week and that doesn't happen, it starts playing, you know.
Maybe something like that, but again, I just go with what's in the menu. It's easy enough, is it?
I think sometimes, like, for me, I won't really go too much into it, and then you're like playing, you're like, fuck, have I too much, or haven't had enough, and you're like, I thought too much about that.
I think the one thing for me, what I do, when kind of, I know that our guys are saying, is the day before, really bulking up on your day before, because you know, no matter how many person people you talk to, they always say the day before that's vital, and that's the one that makes you, you know, have you build up your energy and makes you perform on the day.
I think so. Like, I think if you try to eat too many carbs on the day of the game, it'll be sitting in your system still whenever you're playing.
Yeah.
But again, much like the other stuff, it takes experience to figure out kind of what works for you, like, and it just takes a week at a time. So we'll go on the quick fire round here. We are going to be doing a workout here after, see what's coming up to 9 o'clock. So we'll see what we're like. So quick fire round. Best GAA moment
so far. I'm not trying to win the final. Best one, the goal is that I get on the match.
That's a fairly good one, to be fair. Worst.
I had to win my debut against Donegal, so it didn't go well. But India, I know it was an experience then, and it was my first year in, so I've learned a lot since then. But if you only say one, then it's good to say that.
Yeah. This next one, I'm going to preface. We've actually marked each other before. Whenever Loretto, she played your whole league champion.
Holy Cross.
We played this up in Dungiven, Kevin Lynch's pitches.
Right?
I roasted you.
Maybe that. So, are you the guy?
You blocked it out of your head, probably.
It's all coming through now. It's all coming through.
So, this question is the toughest opponent you faced.
Well, check yourself there.
Obviously.
It's actually a weird one because, you know, when you base that decision, is it a game to be a bad day, or, you know, is it just the fact that you were still there for the moment, the guy was, your marker was on the table. Yeah, but I just remember one day it was Keith Higgins got down in Castle Ballas marking him, and he just seemed a very tricky player, and he was very tight and you know, tough. But again, Finn Schumann, you know, you've got him at the main point, obviously, and maybe two harder men than that mark, you know what I mean?
But that must be a big advantage too, whenever you go out on the pitch, you know that there's not going to be any defenders that are going to be a level higher than that, like, the much you can use earlier.
That's it, like, you know, if I say, to be honest with you, we've made great battles this year, and it's probably helped the three of us, you know, come on, even Martin and Paddles and all the good defenders, so within battles, help you then, you go out to play pretty much.
Yeah. Best drink session after a one?
After a one?
After a one. Oh, actually, best drinking session around football?
I think it's really good about a few after the carry loss, and it was actually a turn of the couple of days, but probably after one, probably done it all. Also fair, a couple years ago, because that's probably your best thing.
Good crack.
It's not on 2 days. Not on a cracker, but I'm definitely
nasty.
That's nice.
Final thing, what's the best advice that you maybe give the young people, or what's like traits do you think are important for any young people or people in general, whether it wants to be getting to the county level or set on whatever they do?
I think it's about never giving up, having that belief in yourself and you know, believing in what you want to do. I always say, you know, I always see what I want to do. If you have it, I always see it well in advance. You know, I always believe you visualize things and all, and you believe in it, then it's going to happen. But you know, success, I think it's really important. Success, it doesn't come in straight lines. And you know, I was working with this over there, Roy Anderson. We were in St Mary's, we met with him basically for a prep talk before that was the year he won the Silver and he said about how success doesn't come in straight lines. You'll be off the left, there'll be setbacks, you'll be off the right, there'll be more setbacks. And you know, if you keep persevering, then you will eventually get to the top. You know, again, I like to use the minors, throw minors as an example of where it was a veered off to the left or the right, where it wasn't, things weren't going well for me in terms of playing and getting minutes in the field. But after that, I said, I stuck at it and I said, no, I'm not giving up on this, I'm going to work hard. And you know, if you just persevere and you have the right attitude, you can go and believe in what you want to do, and you can get there. And obviously, you do need a bit of luck, I'm not going to say you don't, you need a bit of luck along the way. But it's just really having that good attitude, you know that you're going to do everything within your power, make sure you're in the best position to get to that tone level or that level.
Yeah, belief, perseverance, and then just back it up with work, then.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah. Cathal, that was brilliant. Thanks for coming on. We should take your time out.
How much of your time came on?
That was good.
Right,
that was good.
Enough.
That was a good 50 minutes there. By the way, if you didn't ask me anything, it's in
no,
there.
No, no chance.
What were you fixed here? Because I don't want to keep
you. No, I'm not chance. I love the session by the way, so what would you do?
No, I am good. As long as you don't mind being late going up the road.
I'm pretty much a road. I'll come for the year and I'll be on it. My uncle lives. What's it based on?